Okay, let's begin the voyage of the future. This is the inaugural edition of ICA PG Assembly Debate Forum. As sir has mentioned, the participants and judges are already introduced. So I'll quickly go through the format for the benefit of the audience again. The first team postgraduate will place his or her argument. The time limit is 10 minutes. After 8 minutes, they will receive a warning bell and 10th minute closure bell. Next team postgraduate can speak for again 10 minutes with 8 minutes warning and 10 minutes closing bell. How well they manage the time is also important. Then it will be the time for rebuttal, for which they can take the help of their mentoring consultant. So 5 minutes is the time allowed for the consultant, each team. And then we will have a Q&A session with the judges from this particular specialty or super specialty. So judges will conduct a Q&A session on what, when, why, how was their literature, was it authentic? Is there any misinterpretation like that? And the scoring also is going to be uniform for the subsequent episodes of the preliminary round of PG Debate Forum. We'll be evaluating or marking on these subheadings, how they introduce the topic with rationale, how the contents are organized, whether the contents are evidence-based, whether the references are authentic, references are recent or up-to-date, their presentation style, their oratory skills, and time management. Of course, the interactive session with the judges will carry double the weightage. All these subcategories described so far had 10 points out of 100. And the Q&A session and the overall performance together will carry 20 of the maximum 100 marks. And at the end of the session, we should be able to find out the overall score of each team out of 100 marks. So let us start the first ICA PG Assembly debate. As you know, the topic today is TIVA, the total intravenous anesthesia versus volatile anesthetics in neuroanesthesia. The judges for this program debate is already introduced by Dr. Radhakrishnan. I would like to have a preliminary remark from the judges. Dr. G.P. Singh, please.
Well, good evening to everyone. And I thank Dr. Sinesh and Dr. Radhakrishnan for introducing this unique program which you have started by this Indian College of Anesthesiologists. I really think this would be a very attractive program for all the postgraduates. And I'm keen to look forward to it. Myself, I am from All Ministry of Medical Science and would be one of the judges today. So all the best to both the teams. And let's have the next debate now. And I mean introduction rather.
Okay. Thank you very much. Dr. Sri Ganesh Kamath.
Yeah. Good evening, everyone. And Dr. Sanish, thank you for the opportunity. And you selected the apt topic for the inaugural program, that is TIVA and volatile anesthetic in neuroanesthesia. This is an ongoing debate, and I'm sure the two teams will slug it out and bring out the best of the evidence and their experience in defense of the topic allotted to them. Best wishes to both the teams. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Dr. Bhuvan Pandey from Gangaram Hospital. Sir, please, your initial remarks.
Good evening, sir, and thanks for this unique program. Since India is a land of ideas, so it's a unique idea to begin with this program, which will be benefited by, giving benefit to all the students, those who are in the periphery also. So I think it's a very unique and very wonderful initiative, and best wishes from to both the speakers. Thank you.
Thank you very much, sir. Now it's time to start the show. We will start with KEM Hospital and CHGS Medical College, Mumbai. The postgraduate student will be Dr. Gopikrishnan. He'll be speaking in favor of TIVA in neuroanesthesia. It's over to Dr. Gopikrishnan. You can introduce yourself and then your time starts. You can do the screen share now.
Yes. Hello.
Yeah. Okay. You can quickly introduce yourself and then your time starts. Go ahead, yes. Please.
Yeah. Good evening, everybody. Myself, Dr. Gopikrishnan from KEM Hospital, Mumbai. I'm final year resident doctors of KEM Anesthesia. I will be talking in favor of TIVA in neuroanesthesia in this debate. Okay, sir. Fine, sir. We'll start the event.
Okay, you can start.
Yes. Okay, so if you are in a really if you are in a confusion of choosing whether TIVA or inhalational, I'll bring you.
Copy louder, please.
Yeah, hello. Yeah. If you are in a confused state whether to choose TIVA or inhalational in neuroanesthesia, just be with me for the next 10 minutes. I will bring you to where we can choose the TIVA. By definition, TIVA in intravenous anesthesia is achieved using an intravenous hypnotic agent administered along with opioid. Drugs with rapid onset and offset like propofol or remifentanil are most commonly used in TIVA, which can be administered through manual or target-controlled infusion pumps. The target concentration of propofol is 3 to 6 mics per ml. Remifentanil is 2 to 8 nanograms per ml. For sevoflurane, it is 1 to 1.5 mg. The Mass and Schneider's model is used for TCA-based for propofol. And the goals of neuroanesthesia will be hemodynamic stability, maintenance of intracranial tension, and preservation of cerebrovascular reactivity to carbon dioxide, and minimal or no interference with electrophysiological function to facilitate the monitoring and maintenance of cerebral perfusion pressure and cerebral blood volume, intact cerebral autoregulation, and optimal surgical condition, which is relaxed brain. So if we see the advantages of TIVA over inhalational anesthetics, TIVA have advantage over maintaining the cerebral and systemic hemodynamics and minimal and no interference with electrophysiological monitoring and better brain relaxation, neuroprotection, smooth and faster recovery, and better quality of recovery. And TIVA is the only option in awake craniotomies and functional neurosurgeries. And TIVA have advantage in anti-metastatic and anti-cancerous property and post-operative cognitive dysfunction and no greenhouse effect. So in this picture on the right side, we can see that the effect of intravenous anesthetics over the cerebral metabolic rate and cerebral blood flow in intravenous agents, both will be reduced and the coupling is maintained. But in case of volatile anesthetics, the coupling is not maintained and both are going in opposite direction. Because of increase in cerebral blood flow, it increases the cerebral blood volume and results in increase in intracranial pressure, which is not advisable. And in maintaining cerebral hemodynamics, there is a study which compares the propofol and volatile anesthetics. In that, the propofol-based anesthesia provides lower intracranial pressure and higher cerebral perfusion pressure, which results in better cerebral perfusion. Here on the left side, we can see the normal autoregulation curve, cerebral autoregulation curve, where the cerebral blood flow is maintained between 50 to 150, maintained at the same at constant between 50 to 150 millimeters of mercury of mean arterial pressure. On the right side, we can see the effect of volatile anesthetics on cerebral autoregulation. With the increased dose of volatile anesthetics, the autoregulation curve is distorted. With higher dose of inhaled, the interface is almost distorted, and it is dose-dependent flow and luxury flow will be there, which is evident through this study. Here in this study, propofol and sevoflurane is compared through transcranial Doppler under BIS. Here, TIVA is better, TIVA is better, and it produces it preserves the cerebral autoregulation. But sevoflurane is increasing the flow with dose-dependent manner and produce luxury perfusion. And in this study, where the comparison of propofol and sevoflurane during maintenance of anesthesia, the hypertensive events were comparable in both the group, but hypotensive events were more with sevo group. And rescue therapy with labetalol and ephedrine is more with SIVA group. And in electrophysiological monitoring, on the downside, if we see the table, the evoked potential in somatosensory and motor is unchanged with the use of propofol, but it is suppressed with the use of volatile anesthetics. So propofol is the better agent for propofol is a better agent for assessment of evoked potential. And in epilepsy surgery, propofol in awake surgery in sedation dose have minimal effect in spontaneous intractal epileptiform activity. And in case of inhalational agent, it activates both, it both activates and deteriorates the spike activity. Sevoflurane causes dose-dependent epileptiform discharges, which is not advisable. And in other study under general anesthesia, optimal echocardiogram recordings were possible with the use of isoflurane and propofol. And in awake craniotomies, inhalation is not even an option. TIVA is better. TIVA is the only option, and propofol is infused and craniotomy done under local. Spontaneous ventilation is maintained. Whenever we need assessment, we'll discontinue the propofol and restart for the resection and closure. And for brain relaxation, it is very significant in case of intracranial hypertension, base of skull surgery, and it reduces surgical compression and improves perfusion, cerebral perfusion, and prevents cerebral ischemia. And in case of minimal invasive surgery, brain relaxation is very important. And in this study, where they compare TIVA and inhalational, propofol-based anesthesia provides better brain relaxation and maintains a lower ICP and better hemodynamics. And neurosurgeries can results in ischemic brain damage and neuronal death. So oxidative stress and apoptotic activities can trigger because of neurosurgeries, but neuroprotection is very important. And propofol-based anesthesia in this left side in this study where they treated stroke endovascular thrombectomy, here propofol anesthesia improves the functional independence at 3 months and it reduced the 3 months mortality rate. Here in this study, they're telling propofol have antioxidant and scavenging effect and anti-apoptotic effect, and it favors the influence of pro and anti-inflammatory cytokine balance whether compared to isoflurane. And in case of smooth and early recovery, equivalence is found in inhalational and both intravenous, and reaching the average score of 8 is almost equal in both. And in case of post-operative endocrine stress response is better with propofol group, and higher analgesic requirement is noted in case of inhalationals. Post-operative nausea vomiting is a significant problem in case of neurosurgery because it provokes intracranial tension and chances of bleeding, and it causes electrolyte imbalance and chances of bronchoaspiration is increased and patient dissatisfaction occurs. So here in this study, they are telling PONV incidence and severity is less with the TIVA group, not in volatile group. And in case of quality of recovery, the lower incidence of emergence delirium is noted in TIVA group, and patient is better in post-operative period because reduced post-operative pain. And in case of awareness, which was a significant problem before, but with the proper depth of anesthesia monitoring, that awareness can be prevented. In one study, out of 11,433 participants, only 2%, which is 0.017%, which is negligible amount, have awareness, intraoperative awareness issue. And in case of anti-cancer effects and outcome, effects of propofol on cancer cells is being modulated by, the effect of propofol on cancer cells is by both immunomodulation and alteration in tumorigenic growth factor and hypoxia-inducible factor and insulin-like growth factor. In another study, tumor-free recurrence, in case of TIVA group, had a better recurrence-free survival and overall survival after cancer surgery compared to volatile anesthetics. In case of post-operative cognitive dysfunction, incidence of PCOD is higher in elder patient undergoing major surgery under inhalation with sevoflurane compared to intravenous propofol infusion. As an anesthetist, we have a significant role in preventing environmental hazard. So it's a well-known fact that all the volatile anesthetics have a greenhouse effect and ozone damaging effect. Out of all environmental hazard gases, the volatile anesthetics takes part about 0.1%, which is significant. we can prevent by using
no more minutes
intravenous anesthesia. So I told all the benefits of TEVA over volatile anesthetics from the point of initiation of surgery till the post-op recovery, even in the preventing environmental hazards. So now I think there will be no confusion in making choice, as it is TEVA is the better option. And special thanks to our HOD, Dr. Indrani Hemant Kumar and Dr. Anita Shetty for being with me in this presentation. Thank you. Thanks.
Thank you, Dr. Gopi. So that was the first part of the debate. Now it's up to the second team to speak on volatile anesthetics for neuroanesthesia. Dr. Agalya Ilangovan is ready. She's from Madurai Medical College. Dr. Agalya, you can introduce yourselves and then your time will start. You'll get a warning bell at 8 minutes.
Okay. Very good evening, respected chairpersons, delegates, audience, and my dear friends. And I compare taking a neuro case with volatile agents with an air travel, a smooth takeoff, easy gliding, wobbles trajectory, and a safe landing. Yes, I'm Dr. Agalya Langovan, third year postgraduate from Madurai Medical College. I'm here to advocate about the use of volatile agents in neuroanesthesia. The advantages of volatile agents are easy administration, smooth onset, uniform depth, easy titration, good hemodynamic stability, no accumulation, and easy recovery. With all the advantages, why the topic of debate came into the first place? It is because of the property of the ancestral volatile agent that is carried, that has been carried till recently, blindfolded. But the situation is different today. Modern understanding into physiology of the cranial contents and pharmacology of the modern volatile agents made us to reconsider the prior beliefs. Cerebral blood flow. Now we are going into the foundation of the neuroanesthesia, the points favorable to the volatile anesthetics, the trials and results. Cerebral blood flow depends on cerebral autoregulation, vasomotor reactivity, and neurovascular coupling. The first impression may be a bad impression for the hero. In all the books, it is given that it increases ICP, blah, blah, blah. But in subsequent paragraphs, it is given all the volatile anesthetics increase only in dose-dependent manner, that is supra-therapeutic level. Any drug which is given in higher dose pose problem to the patient. But what happens in the cerebral autoregulation? It is an integrated regulation. It is not only depend upon the MAP. It is dependent on the cardiac output, metabolic activity, TACO2 changes. So it is an integrated regulation where volatile anesthetic has favorable effects in all the subconditions. And special mention about ICP. ICP depends on the other four subconditions, that is CSF volume, fluid compartment, cellular compartment, blood volume. In the blood volume, which is related to ICP, the majority of bloods are sequestered in the venous circulation. Thereby, the cerebral, as the volatile agents are super blamed, that it increases cerebral blood flow. It is not so. The cerebral blood flow does not have a direct measure of cerebral blood volume, thereby ICP. And what it does to cerebral blood flow actually is the net effect. There is a reduction in the cerebral metabolism more than 50%, thereby reduces the CBF with the intrinsic cerebral vasodilatory activity. In supratherapeutic doses, it may increase the CBF. So CBF is a net effect of both these. From the object CBF, it reduces in 1 mAC, which is therapeutic concentration. It 1 mAC, it reduces so much, more than 50%, whereby it reduces the CBF and reduces the ICP. And with modern invention of technologies, a PET image showing 1.5 mAC of CO fluorine when compared with propofol, the cerebral blood flow is comparable. And in CO fluorine group, there is dose-dependent increase in cerebral blood flow. In 1.5 mAC, there is comfortable, which is comfortable for taking a neuro case. Autoregulation. There are two types of autoregulation, the static and dynamic. Static autoregulation comes for long term. Dynamic regulation is the minute to minute variation. Yeah, maybe in the intraoperative period. CO fluorine in 1.5 mAC preserves both static and dynamic autoregulation. And a study done by Basil Mata shows that in isofluorine desfluorine group also in 1 mAC, cerebral autoregulation is intact. Cerebral metabolic rate. From the awake cerebral metabolic rate, the 1 mAC volatile agents reduces is more than 50%, which is needed for reduction of the cerebral blood flow and thereby ICP. A special mention about neurovascular coupling. In olden days, neuroscraping was thought to be only a feedback mechanism. But now, there is one more mechanism, feed-forward mechanism for neurovascular coupling. And during the birth and suppression phases in isoflurane anesthesia, it is found that the velocity of the MCA increases and decreases respectively. Thereby, it preserves the coupling in CMR and CBF in isoflurane anesthesia. That is, the neurovascular coupling is maintained and modified, which is given in authentic textbooks. And about the vasopressin, CO2 responsiveness is well maintained during volatile anesthetics. And an interesting fact is that when the resting blood flow is rapid, as in volatile anesthetics, hypocapnia-induced reduction in the cerebral blood flow is more intense. So, reduction in the cerebral blood flow and reduction in the ICP is possible during a volatile anesthetic agent. In terms of cerebral oxygenation, many investigations are done to measure the jugular venous oxygenation, which is a reflection of the cerebral oxygenation, and near infrared spectroscopy proves that cerebral oxygenation is well maintained with CO4 and anesthesia. So it could be a better choice in patients with the risk of cerebral hypoxia or insufficient oxygen delivery than propofol. It maintains cerebral perfusion pressure. It decreases the cerebral oxygen extraction ratios. Neuroprotection. Neuroprotection is the cornerstone of neuroanesthesia nowadays. Sevoflurane and other volatile agents provides both mechanisms, cytoprotective and preconditioning effect. Cytoprotective is by NMDA blocking activity and GABA receptor enhancing activity. A booster dose for a volatile agent is that it has possessed some preconditioning effects till up to 4 days. And isoflurane also has some post-conditioning effect by various mechanisms, by activation of ATP-dependent potassium channels, anti-apoptotic factors, antioxidant mechanism, NOA synthesis mechanism. The preconditioning effects is well pronounced. The neuroprotection during ischemic injury. The critical cerebral blood flow is 20 ml per 100 gram per minute. But in an anesthetized brain with sevoflurane and isoflurane, it is well tolerated, up to 10 ml per 100 gram per minute. And in better recovery profile is with sevoflurane. And in children's, even better recovery profiles are seen. In comparison with outcomes, in both the traumatic brain injury group and the elective surgery group, there is differences in the Glasgow Coma Scale, and differences in the survival is comparable. No significant survival differences were seen, even in elective surgeries in patients with brain tumors. The type of anesthesia that doesn't impact the survival benefit. And special mention about cardiovascular stability. Sevoflurane seems to be, all volatile agents seems to be superior myocardial stability in both normal and compromised heart than propofol. And the study done by Catherine M. Duffy and Basil F. Mata shows that sevoflurane is an ideal anesthetic agent for neuroanesthetic practice. And I conclude with the disadvantage of PIVA. There's numerous IV agents are direct myocardial depressant, accumulation and long duration of drug pose potential delayed emergence properties. And in severe ischemic brain injury cases, neuroprotective propofol fails. Administration of PIVA in obesity has limited use. And cerebral oxygenation is decreased as we investigated with many measures in propofol group. It is quite costlier. TCAE system is quite costlier. And here, lactic acidosis is a which is seen as an earlier finding in propofol infusion syndromes, is seen even in intraoperative periods in a shorter duration where they receive infusions. The potential problem in manual titration when in an inexperienced hand with target control infusion setup, the awareness which may raise ICP is a potential problem, and delayed emergence due to overshoot of drugs is seen. Technical errors, drug reflexes, stasis in the tubing should also be considered. Yes. I conclude again with the Miller's reference. Volatile anesthetics have a definite role in neuroanesthesia in contrast to previous belief. It is not wiser to exclude volatile anesthetic completely from neuroanesthetic practice. Thank you. Thank you for my mentor and my department and everyone for giving me this opportunity. Thank you.
2 minutes more. Okay, Dr. Agarwalia, you managed to finish with 2 minutes left. Okay. You can unshare the screen now. So the first part of the Voice of the Future is done. We heard from Dr. Gopikrishnan. We heard from Dr. Agarwalia. Okay, the PG debate continues. And now with the permission of the judges, shall I move to the second portion, that is rebuttal session, We'll start with the KEM Mumbai team. So we'll wait for Dr. Anita Shetty to get ready.
Dr. Sanita, I'm ready.
Yes, okay, fine. You can introduce yourself and start. Again, you have
Thank you, 5 minutes.
Dr.
Tanish and Dr. ICA for giving us this opportunity. I'm Dr. Anita Shetty, working as a professor in KEM Hospital, Mumbai. What I would like to tell is ultimately what matters in neuroanesthesia is the cerebral hemodynamic effects, that is cerebral blood flow, CMRO2, oxygen reactivity, mean arterial pressure, and cerebral blood flow. All these beneficial effects are seen with propofol, and especially inhalational agents can be an alternative to TEVA when there is no increase in intracranial pressure. But when there is an increase in intracranial pressure or an impaired brain regulation, then it cannot replace TEVA, especially when TEVA is used with TCI pump and depth of anesthesia monitoring. And she said something about the jugular venous oximetry. There is a study done by effect of increasing concentration of propofol on jugular bulb venous saturation in neurosurgical patients under normothermia and mild hypothermia condition. And they found that with the normal concentration of propofol from 3 to 7 mics per ml did not affect the SgO2 values or incidence of desaturation in both the group. So as long as you maintain the dose from 3 to 7 mics per ml, there is no desaturation or no decrease in SgO2. Regarding the this thing, 1 minute. So as I already told you, the ICP will be maintained in normal intracranial compliance. But if the ICP is already high, then we should go drugs which will reduce the ICP, and that is propofol. Third is in tumor surgery, it is only in glioblastoma they found that there was no difference between sevoflurane and propofol. But 1 year survival was better with propofol, and multiple studies done on breast surgeries, esophageal cancer, they have shown that TEVA has long-term survival is better. The recovery with sevoflurane and propofol is equivalent. Only the recovery with desflurane is faster, but desflurane is not an ideal agent for neuroanesthesia because the cerebral vasodilatation is more. The least vasoconstrictive effect of the inhalational agent is with sevoflurane. So when you compare, there are studies with sevoflurane and propofol, the recovery profile is better. In obese patients, the desflurane is definitely better. And the quality of recovery, that is the post-operative nausea, vomiting, the incidence of pain, the incidence of emergence, all these qualities are less with total intravenous anesthesia. And as already Gopi has said, in awake craniotomy, when you want to use conscious sedation, definitely TEVA is a better agent. Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Sanish.
Okay. Thank you, ma'am. Am I audible?
Yes.
Okay. Now we'll move ahead to the second part of rebuttal. Dr. Shiva Prasad from Madurai Medical College, speaking in favor of volatile in neuroanesthetics.
At the outset, I would like to thank ICA for giving us this opportunity. Thank you very much, sir. Very good evening to the chairpersons, colleagues, my seniors, teachers, and my friends. I'm here to give a rebuttal speech for using TEVA in neuroanesthesia. My main contentions are the changes in cerebral blood flow, neuroprotection offered by TEVA, the TEVA administration logistics, and what happens in neuromonitoring. So, reduction in CBF, which is by TEVA, is it always good? It is clear that the flow metabolism is coupled and autoregulation is maintained in TEVA, but sometimes hemodynamic instability induced by the TEVA, it reduces the CBF, and it's not good, and especially in sitting position in neurosurgery, traumatic brain injury, and extremes of age and cerebrovascular diseases, which is discussed in detail in the study. And coming to the flow metabolic coupling, the cerebral blood flow measured by PET scans is reduced more with propofol compared with sevoflurane. And this reduction will show itself in a decrease in jugular bulb venous saturations. And with giving a hyperventilation, that is going for a hypocapnia, propofol further reduces the jugular bulb oxygen saturation below 50%, indicating critical cerebral perfusion. So this might be dangerous in people who have cerebrovascular diseases. coming to the effect of TIVA in hyperventilation response, recent understanding in the sensitivity of the cerebral vasculature to hyperventilation, it says that it is positively correlated with the resting level of CBF. Here we have a TIVA which is reducing the resting level of CBF. So inducing hypocapnia and reducing the ICP will be a little bit difficult when we use TIVA as a regime in the anesthetic management. What about brain relaxation? Major meta-analysis done comparing propofol and volatile agents where Medline, Cochrane, Embrace databases were searched. In that study, they have used the primary outcome as brain relaxation score, and secondary parameters studied were the cerebral perfusion pressures. They studied 14 studies involving 18,819 patients. Though they found that ICP was much lower, the brain relaxation score was similar in both groups. This study is a landmark study, and it says that both groups have similar brain relaxation scores. Coming to neuroprotection, the major trials, the Siesta and Goliath trials, they fail in a certain aspect of neuroprotection, in that they fail to recognize agent-specific neuroprotection and state-specific neuroprotection. So only one place where agent-specific neuroprotection was tried, and that also didn't establish, was in a cardiac surgery. And and to add to it, the preconditioning effect of volatile anesthetics is not well established for any IV anesthetic agent. And when we compare ischemic damage induced during the surgery, the distal amount of distal hypoxia and tissue acidosis is more with the ETOM rate than when we use desflurane. So you can clearly see that no desflurane treated patient showed a new neurological deficit on occlusion of middle cerebral artery.
2 minutes more, sir.
Yes, sir. And potential problems with TIVA administration, sir. It needs a high amount of training and skill. It requires special equipments for delivery, and models of infusion should be clearly defined before we start the case, and monitoring of plasma levels and clinical effects are necessary. And to add to it, it is very difficult in administering obese and pediatric and geriatric patients. Awareness is a big problem if we don't follow the protocols properly. And during long administration, hemodynamic instability and accumulation of drug can occur. And potential problem is propofol infusion syndrome, especially in the pediatric age group. Coming to neuromonitoring, SSCP is said to be more affected in than TC-MEP when we use volatiles. But what can we do is, we can lower the concentration of volatile agents, and it is said that lesser potent desflurane is better when we use evoked potential monitoring. Upper limb stimulation is preferred to lower limb, and high frequency amplitude stimulations can come over the problem of evoked potential monitoring. The flip side is, though the evoked potential monitoring is disturbed when we use volatiles, what they have given in Miller is the difference is some relevance in neuroprotective potential of the volatile agents that can produce EEG suppression. To summarize, CBF is reduced, CMR is also reduced, but it can compromise perfusion. This is evident in reduction in SGVO of the propofol group. The response to hyperventilation is less when TIVA is used. Brain relaxation is similar when TIVA and volatiles are used. Neuroprotection is superior when volatile is used. Administration of TIVA needs greater expertise and monitoring. Neuromonitoring can be done with some modifications. And to add up the greenhouse effect, in the era of low flow anesthesia, greenhouse effect is similar, especially when sevoflurane is used, because the lifetime of sevoflurane in the atmosphere is very, very less. So in the era of low flow anesthesia, it should not be a problem. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Prasad, for stopping at exactly at 5 o'clock, 5 minutes time.
Thank you, sir.
So to remind our audience, we are actually thankful to both the mentoring faculty from KEM Mumbai and Madurai Medical College. But this is PG assembly. Our evaluation doesn't apply to the faculty or consultants. Okay, so we have a scoring system. Now it's over to our judges for the Q&A session with the postgraduate participants for clarifying the points they have raised during the debate. It's over to the judges.
Okay, I congratulate both the teams for putting their views and justifying that. Well, my first question will go to Mumbai, KA Mumbai, who presented in favor of intravenous. So you told so many things in favor of intravenous agents in your anesthesia. Okay. In spite of that, if a patient is not having raised ICP, does not have any concerns of edema, and when there are certain advantages have been told by your counterpart, how you justify use of intravenous agents in such cases when there is a drug inhalation agents available where you have faster recovery like desflurane now. So is there still a place for IV now here in these patients?
Sir, as neurosurgery is concerned, the patient with pathology, almost more than half of the patients will be having raised ICT. So in case of raised ICT, TY is better, one thing. The other thing is patient... So in case of cerebral hemodynamics, in case of cerebral hemodynamics, the cerebral metabolic rate and cerebral perfusion coupling is not maintained. It is evident. One study tells with 0.3 mAC, the cerebral perfusion is maintained. Beyond that, the cerebral perfusion is not maintained. But in case of TEVA, the coupling is maintained and both the flow and metabolism is going in the same direction. That is one advantage, sir. And another advantage, in case of post-operative period and patient's comfort, as we see, the context-sensitive elimination is almost same for both intravenous and inhalational. But in case of inhalational, based on the duration of surgery and the concentration used, the recovery time and the context sensitivity elimination for volatile anesthetics is also more. But in case of TEVA, whatever may be the duration, once we stop the drug, the concentration will come down with same, independent of the duration of the anesthesia used. So the recovery is better in TEVA in long surgeries. And along with this fast recovery, we have better recovery. And one more thing is patient won't be having post-operative nausea, vomiting in case of propofol. So patient satisfaction is more. And in case of post-operative nausea, vomiting, there is a chance of increased intracranial tension in the post-operative period, along with increased in the chance of bleeding from the operative site. Along with that, most of the neurosurgeries are concerned related to cancer surgeries. And we have evidence in cancer survival and cancer, post-cancer survival and mortality rate in case of TEVA is better in TEVA-based anesthesia. But this advantage is not in case of volatile anesthetics, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay.
Thank you, sir. Yeah.
Now the question to the other team. What is the evidence regarding use of inhalation agents during neuromuscular monitoring, neurophysiological monitoring? Is it justified? Can you justify use of inhalation agents when you are going for this monitoring?
Sir, actually, neurophysiological monitoring, volatile agents cannot be used. But there is a strong neuroprotection seen with all these neuroprotective benefit seen with volatile agents. And in submac concentration, even sevoflurane can be used for neuromonitoring in recent studies and advances.
Do you have some evidence for this? Some recent study you can quote?
Yes, sir. I have one journal. pro-inhalational. I have already given it in my study.
So what MAC would you like to keep in such patients? I mean,
0.5 MAC with sevoflurane.
Okay. And how will you post-operative cognitive dysfunction is one of the concerns with inhalational. And we actually want one of the important aspects is immediate post-op recovery and fast recovery and what you say is immediate neurological assessment. So is there anything you would like to tell about POCD and post-op recovery?
Sir, actually we are using inhalation in anesthetics in most of the neurosurgeries, and as it is documented in Miller's anesthesia, it can be used in most of the neurosurgeries, both elective and traumatic brain injury cases. The post-operative cognitive dysfunction is not evidenced that much as proposing a problem. And we cannot say it is only because of the volatile anesthetics, because in injury in patient, there is already a cerebral ischemia or cerebral insult. We cannot directly post accusation on only the volatile anesthetic cause that cognitive dysfunction. All brains are compromised brain we take for surgeries. As there is so much of neuroprotective mechanism in volatile anesthesia, preconditioning, post-conditioning effect, I don't think so. There will be much evidence in post-operative cognitive dysfunction with volatile.
Okay, fine. Dr. Shekhanesh, would you like to ask?
Yeah. Thank you, Gopi and Alia. Excellent presentation. Both of you defended your side well. In fact, Gopi played like Rishabh Pant to begin with. And couple of questions to him. Gopi?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So in your day-to-day practice, which technique do you use?
Sir, we are using TEWA with depth of anesthesia monitoring, sir.
Okay. That is your standard practice for every case?
Yes, sir. We are using standard practice.
Very good. You must be the unique center which follows what is preached, probably. Most of the centers don't do that. So I'm pleasantly surprised if that is true. Okay, that is one. Second one is, especially in pediatric, long duration neurosurgeries, which go on for 8 hours, 10 hours, 12 hours, you still prefer to use propofol as your main anesthetic agent in TEWA. Is that correct?
Yes, sir. I think I haven't seen, we haven't done till now any long pediatric cases in neurosurgery because currently I don't have any idea. Yeah.
Okay. So you have been practicing TEWA for a long time for neurosurgical cases. So you have not seen any propofol infusion syndromes or metabolic acidosis or myocardial depression in any of your patients.
No, sir.
Is that correct?
Yes, sir. Till now I haven't seen any case of propofol infusion, and even the evidence shows that the propofol infusion syndrome is more common.
Yeah, evidence you have projected. I'm just asking since your center, which
Sir, I haven't seen. We haven't seen any cases.
So unless what did you see to detect propofol infusion syndrome? Well, that is important. Unless you know what you want to see, you'll not see it.
Patient will be having muscle related issues, sir. I mean, muscular issue, and lactic acidosis is more common in case of propofol infusion syndrome.
So you routinely
and
perform
proteinuria and AKI can be caused.
Okay, so you look for each of these in all your patients where you administer TEWA for long duration, more than 6 hours at least.
Yes, sir. We'll follow up in that. Yeah.
Okay, and two virtues of TEWA you did not explain in your presentation. One was, as Dr. Gyananda rightly pointed out, on post-operative cognitive dysfunction. And second, the advantage of continuing the similar anesthetic in the post-operative ICU period. Some patients, at least about 10 to 15% of them, require post-operative ICU care. And it is preferable that you continue the similar anesthetic that you administer in the intraoperative period. That is the advantage of TEWA, which you did not explain. Okay. Now, if your patient has TBI and hypotension, traumatic brain injury with hypotension, would you still go ahead with propofol induction maintenance for your TIVA?
TBA with hypotension.
You might maintain blood pressure with vasopressors, but remember that both can cause vasoconstriction, including cerebral vascular constriction. Okay.
With the TCA pumps, we can maintain, but in our institution, we don't have a TCA pumps. So it is better to, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Fine. Thank you. Great. Okay.
Thank you.
Dr. Alia.
Sir.
Okay. So what do you practice in your institute?
Sir, for majority of the cases, we use inhalation. And for some cases, we use IV anesthetics.
Okay. So if you find that intraoperatively brain is full, do you still continue with inhalation agents or you feel TIVA has a superiority in that situation?
Sir, with the wrist monitoring and I just will try the therapeutic dose of inhalation, does it exceed? And I'll try with some hyperventilation strategies.
You should be using therapeutic dose of inhalation agent for any anesthesia, not less, not more. In case brain is full during anesthesia and surgery, my question is very specific. Do you switch over to TIVA or continue giving inhalation anesthetic?
Sir, if hyperventilation fails in the benefit of patient, I will switch over to TIVA.
Okay. And second question was already answered regarding IONM. So I'll not go to that. Do you use nitrous oxide in your neuroanesthesia practice? That is the inhalation agent, which was commonly used for several decades.
Yes, sir. Until and we don't have a tight brain, we used nitrous for that. And it is evidence that the ICP rise due to nitrous can be completely abolished by hyperventilation.
Okay, thank you.
And we use, starting to use air also.
Okay, thank you. Thank you. Over to Dr. Rabuan.
First of all, excellent presentation by both the speakers, and then first of its kind debate. My first question is to Mr. Dr. Gopikrishnan. You said you are preferring TIVA over inhalation, right? So,
yes,
could you please tell me, when you use inhalation, you see MAC, and according to MAC, you increase or decrease the inhalation, right? And you come to know whether patient is receiving 1 MAC, and you are sure that the patient most probably will not have any awareness. Now with TIVA, you will not have any MAC. So how will you assess the awareness during this procedure, surgery?
Sir, in case of TIVA, it was previously it was a problem with TIVA, sir, but currently we have a depth of anesthesia monitoring, like EEG based monitoring, like BIS. We can assess the patient's depth of anesthesia and we can keep it with the normal limit from 40 to 60. So that can prevent the awareness, intraoperative awareness, and there is a clear evidence which shows proper BIS monitoring can prevent interruptive awareness in TIVA.
Okay. Have you seen any abnormal reading during BIS monitoring if the patient is, say, slightly light? Then you can see the changes in the BIS numbers, BIS scoring, right?
Yes, sir.
So yeah. During that time also, there can be disturbance. So, okay, that's okay. And you said in your slide, this propofol is not having any effect on greenhouse effect, right?
Yes, sir. Yeah.
So what type of pollution this propofol can cause if the management regarding discarding is not done properly?
Yes, sir. We cannot use propofol for more than 6 hours. Because of oil emulsion and egg lecithin, there is a chance of infection. And if we use it beyond 6 hours, which can cause, which can induce infection in patients, sir.
Right. No, my question is, inhalation, you said it can cause greenhouse effect.
Yes.
environmental pollution, air pollution, right?
Yes, sir.
But what type of pollution this propofol can cause and how to prevent it?
No idea, sir. Sorry.
This actually, normally, if you use 20 ml syringe, 20 ml vial, and you use 10 ml only, and the 10 ml is left. So if you keep it there only, and one of your technical staff or anybody can discard it in drain, so which can cause water pollution, and which should be properly discarded, and can could be sent to incinerator, and which is treated with more than 1000 degrees Celsius, then only it can be properly discarded. Otherwise, it can cause harm. Right. Okay. That's okay from my side. Nice presentation, Gopi. My next question is to Madam Agalya.
Yes, sir.
Nice presentation.
Thank you.
As you said, the inhalation is also is very effective and giving good brain relaxation and proper conditioning to the brain. No side effect, right? So, which inhalation agent will decrease the, you can say, air pollution? And how to decrease the air pollution in OT? What are the means to decrease the air pollution?
Sir, in the era of low flow anesthesia,
right,
and air pollution is negligible. And with good, simple scavenging systems, which is we are very familiar with now due to COVID era, can prevent theater pollution. Sir, CO fluorine can be used in low concentrations.
No, you cannot use low concentration because MAC is required. Adequate MAC is required to avoid awareness, right?
Sir.
But low flow can
low
be
flow
used,
can
yes.
be done.
Right. And what else can be done to decrease the pollution in OT? Because whatever is going from the vaporizer, it will go into atmosphere, maybe outside OT, but it will go, right? But how to decrease the pollution inside OT to prevent ourselves?
With proper scavenging systems and multimodal anesthesia, a balanced anesthesia with volatile.
That you decrease the flow, one thing, and in addition, you can unnecessarily you should not flush the oxygen button so that there will no gushing of air from here to there. And while intubating, you should switch off the airflow, not the vaporizer, right? So there, and the leaks should not be there. And once this inhalation is out from the body, or MAC is very low, then only you extubate the patient. So that you should prevent the environment and you will be able to prevent ourselves, right? Thank you very much.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
So we come to the conclusion of the PG debate. Now it's the time for verdict. We'll give a minute for the judges to start putting the marks. Okay, I hope the senior consultants and the stalwarts of the specialty, many I can recognize among the audience, would have enjoyed the nice blend of the voice of the future, supported by their mentors and interacting with the great judges from the concerned specialty. So now we'll move on to the judgment part. So the three judges now will be putting the scores. So there are now, first we'll see the score of Madurai Medical College. So the scoring subcategories are introduction to the debate topic with rationale, how they organize the contents, whether their contents were evidence-based, whether references were authentic, references recent or up-to-date, how was their presentation style, their oratory skills, time management. All these 8 subcategories are going to be graded on a scale of 10. judges, please join the link. I have put the link onto the chat also for you. Yes. Two judges have submitted their verdict. So as of now, the score, yeah, all three judges have put their marks. This is for Madurai Medical College. So it is 7.7 is the average score. That means their average score out of 80 is 61.6. So we have some more categories remaining. We'll move ahead to the next category. Now, this is the turn of KM and Seth GS Medical College, Mumbai. We'll wait for the verdict. Actually, we decided to give the subcategories so that the postgraduates who are watching, the mentoring consultants for the future participants should be more familiar with this scoring system. We are planning to stick on to the same grading system for the coming forthcoming editions of this preliminary round of PG debates so that we can select the two best teams to contest for the annual final PG debate round, where there won't be any more mentoring consultants. So PGs will have to present their arguments. They only have to defend their arguments. So let us see how much is the score for Mumbai, Seth GS Medical College, Mumbai. Okay, one judge score has come. We'll wait for the, all three judges have given their marks. So the average here is 7.5. So in the first part, KEM Mumbai scores 60 out of 80. Now the vital part, the question answer, Q&A session and the overall performance. First, let us know the score of Madurai Medical College. Judges, please note, both the categories will be scored out of a maximum of 10. So now we are coming to know about the score out of 20, the remaining 20. Initial part was 80 marks, now 20 more marks. Yes. So it's good to note that all three judges are putting their scores independently. There is no scope for a consultation between the judges. Okay, one more judge. Yes, so 8 plus 8, 16. So their total score is 77.6. Now we will see what's the score for Seth GS Medical College, Mumbai. Remember, there is no winner loser for a particular contest. This is going to be a long-time selection process. We can even see both these two teams themselves contesting in the final round, because it's all about accumulating the scores, and we'll take the top two teams performing throughout the year. Okay. So it's all about selecting two teams, though they will be contesting in different sessions. So all three judges have given their verdict. So it is 7.7, 15.4. So the total score is 75.44. Mumbai. Okay, so Madurai College scores 77.6 and Seth GS Mumbai Medical College scores 75.4. We'll take this forward. This scorecard will be maintained, and we'll move ahead and see how the subsequent teams in the next months and forthcoming months PG debate fares. Thank you very much for the time, enthusiasm shown by the postgraduates and their respective departments, I would like to personally thank the head of the departments of the both the participants' institutions, Dr. Indrani and Dr. Selvakumar, for supporting this ICA initiative to bring the voice of the future forward in front of a national audience. Maybe this will go to an international audience as well. We are trying to provide the opportunity to the youngsters. Any remarks from the judges? Sir, please.
Okay. Well, I congratulate both the teams for a very nice presentation. It's not a matter of marks. You presented very well. It was, and the good thing that you put your points very aptly, and you justified your points. And you know, the debate is still on. You cannot prove that this is more better. This one technique is better than other. You have different situations where you need different kind of anesthesia and you have to modify techniques. So no one technique suits all. And you must have gone through a Cochrane review also, which still says that there is no good evidence, or all the evidence which is available is very low powered evidence. So we cannot say that inhalation is better than intravenous, but yes, every technique has its benefit, and you have definitely justified your part on it. So I am really happy the way you presented. And again, I would really thank Dr. Ashanish and the whole team of this who have really worked out and thought of such an idea. And this is an excellent idea. I believe people would be very much interested to join here and take part and obviously motivate others and will bring best out of them. So I am really impressed by the idea, and thank you and congratulations to all once again.
For the benefit of postgraduates, I would just like to make a couple of comments. One, when you select a particular technique, we have to remember that it is not what drug or technique that you use, it is how it is used. That has more significance, importance, relevance than what drug or technique you use. That is the first thing. Second, most of you have covered from the perspective of a clinician what he considers as important, like ICP, CPP, cerebral blood flow, flow metabolism coupling, seizure potential, monitoring. These are all from the clinician's perspective. If you really go by what patient feels important, is he bothered about ICP, CPP, CBF? No. What matters to him is whether he develops new neurological deficits after surgery, whether he has a in-hospital or delayed mortality, or the cost of the treatment, or the length of hospital stay. None of these techniques have significantly shown to be superior over the other in terms of patient-important outcomes. And that's what we need to consider from that perspective as well. And on that count, both techniques, as of now, appear to be equivalent. Second, I would like to thank Dr. Sanish, Dr. Radhakrishna sir, and entire ICA for excellent concept, new initiative, and I'm sure many more academicians will take this forward, this idea which has been germinated today by the beginning of the first debate. And both the candidates have done excellently well. Congratulations to both. And I compliment Dr. Sanish and ICA for beginning of this initiative. Thank you once again.
You have rightly said, Dr. Sri Ganesh, it doesn't matter what you use, fever or inhalation, but what is important is how to use it. See, in India, there is too much of discrepancies there. In periphery, you have only inhalation or you have only fever, whatever. So whatever you have, you should have a very good use of it for the better patient outcome. And this is a very good initiative, Dr. Sanish and whole ICA team. Thanks for organizing such type of event, such a nice event. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I would like to compliment all the participants and the judges for their support to make this program a grand success. And I would like to invite our ICA President, Dr. Radhakrishnan, to present the E certificate for the postgraduate participants for this debate. Radhakrishna sir.
Yes, I am available.
Yes. So the first certificate to Dr. Agalya Ilangovan.
I thank Agalya, Agalya Sumender Shivaprasad, head of the department Shelva, and from Save GS, Dr. Indrani Kumar, Indrani Kumar's wards, Anita Shetty and Gopi Krishnan, as well as our revered judges, Gyanendra, Shiganesh, and Bhuvan. Thank you very much for being with us to conduct this particular program. And this program, we want more refinement. In fact, that is the one thing which we look for, because we want it absolutely foolproof way of conducting a debate, because we are encouraging the students' attitude, how to come and answer. Because as you said correctly, Ganesh was telling, which is supported by Bhuvan, it is not the way we use a particular technique that matters, not a particular drug or what is said in the test book. That's not, because these are all there to give us some opinion. But as far as a patient is concerned, well, the way we use that matters. And again, for the debate, where you stand, you defend for that particular matter. Okay. And once again, I thank you very much for joining us. And I give the e-certificate to all of you. I give the certificate to Agalya. Will you pass the certificate, Sanesh? Hello, Gopi Krishna? Agalya Ilangovan?
Yeah. Both the participants will be receiving the e-certificate by email.
This is only a matter of satisfaction to show that we are raising a certificate.
So this will be our next week's program, again on neuroanesthesia.
But there will be no debate. Debate only next month.
Mm-hmm. So we'll be having a postgraduate debate on obstetric anesthesia topic. The topic and the teams will announce through our website.
And if you have any comments or suggestion or any particular innovation you want, please write to us over the email or call us up and talk which way it has to be modified. And we are looking for your intervention in every particular attitude of always in the conduct. Thank you, Sanish. Give a formal auto thanks.
Thank you very much, sir. One minute. Jayashree ma'am is not available. Okay, fine. So I take this opportunity to thank all my postgraduate friends who participated. And I think I could recognize some of my teachers also among the audience. I thank everybody for your excellent participation and support. I specifically would like to thank all three judges, Dr. G.P. Singh, Dr. Sri Ganesh, and Dr. Bhuvan, for their support during the preparation for this program, and their excellent quality moderating judging for the first ICAPG debate. I thank the head of the departments and faculty and the postgraduates of KEM Mumbai and Madurai Medical College for their support to bring out this inaugural edition. I thank all the ICA officials for this opportunity. Now we are continuing with the ICA PG forum as well. So once in a month, we'll have a postgraduate session. So that's it for the time being. Thank you very much once again. Good night and goodbye. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, everyone. Good night.
Thank you. Good night. Good night to all.
Thank you. Thank you, everyone. Thank you. Bye. Good night. So.